We know how they did it. Now, the Piddingtons were a husband and wife act who fooled the whole world into believing that they could literally transmit thought messages using ESP to one another in complete silence, without any spoken codes, without any visual clues. It was amazing. Today, 7 decades later, no one has figured it out. Or have they?
This is to be their most exacting test yet. The object? To transmit a train of thoughts to Mrs. Piddington 20,000 feet up from a studio in Piccadilly, where before judges Hugh Williams and Gladys Young, Sidney Piddington opens the proceedings.
The judges on the broadcasts were legitimate judges. They were sirs, ladies, movie stars, well-known actors of the time. They were trusted by the public, and they had to be, because they were there to represent the eyes of the listening audience, to make sure everything was true and fair.
Are you ready for us over in the starter cruiser at Gilbert Harding?
Yes, we are here, still gaining height. I'm moving even further away from Leslie Piddington. And here is Jean Gordon, a stewardess. What did you do with Mrs. Piddington a few minutes ago?
I searched her very thoroughly in spite of the cold. I made her take off everything. I looked in the padding of her jackets. I looked in her boots. I even looked in her mouth and her hair. And now I have her handbag, so I think you can be sure she's nothing hidden away anywhere on her person.
Well, here we are still rocking about, and back to you, Sydney, in Piccadilly.
In 1949, the BBC broadcast 8 live radio shows demonstrating the powers of the Piddingtons.
Just before we crossed over to the Shadow Cruiser, I asked all of you in the studio here to write something down, or to draw a picture, or provide something to be used later in this program. I also asked you to insert those, whatever they may be, in numbered envelopes which were issued to you as you arrived in the studio this evening. And the enclosed contents will form the subject to be transmitted to Leslie. Is that all clear?
20 million listeners tuned in every week to hear demonstrations of telepathy that were so convincing that to this day, nearly 70 years later, no one has figured out how they did it.
The subject to be transmitted is chosen at random, and Piddington first hears of it from one of the judges. Can he transmit it to his wife?
So yeah, you've got Leslie up in the air, thousands of feet, Sydney in the studio, and they're about to transmit something to each other. Now, the envelopes that were chosen from the audience, 150 different envelopes, and 2 numbers were randomly selected. They were selected by one of the judges, and there was no sleight of hand or switching or any of that modus operandi going on whatsoever, because Sydney didn't need to resort to that sort of magicianship, if you like. His methods were a little bit more cunning than that.
Will you get Leslie to stand by right now?
Will you stand by, please? She is now standing by.
Now, hang on a minute, I can read your mind. Now, you're probably thinking that the fact that they've asked Leslie to stand by has some sort of hidden connotation or code within it that gives her the answers. This isn't true. The only reason they're asking Leslie to stand by aloud is so Sydney, sending his thoughts, sync up with Leslie receiving them.
A bird. One bird. Someone talking. Someone saying hello. Out of it. Oh, it's 2 lines. Bird, spin. Hello. Oh, I've got it. I can guess it. Hail to thee, blithe spirit. Bird, thou never wert. I think it's very nice. In fact, whoever thought of it, hail to thee.
Hail to thee, blithe spirit. Bird, thou never wert.
Thank you.
Brilliant, wasn't it? And that was just one of many demonstrations they did. All of the demonstrations they did were as baffling as that. The main reason for it was Sydney transmitted his thoughts to Leslie in complete silence. he didn't say anything, which means there was no spoken word code that could be accused. And when he did his telepathy act in the studio, he was blindfolded. Therefore, no visual code could be accused. So how were they doing it? Well, the science community decided, unofficially, it must be telepathy. And they begged them over and over again, please let us test you. And they said no. There it is. You be the judge.
Well, there it is. You may believe it, or you may not, but you are the judge.
So the show was on the air. Everything was going great. They were raking in listeners by the millions. Everyone was trying to figure out how it was done. But do you know what? No one could. And neither Sydney nor Leslie wanted to reveal their secrets to anybody. And in fact, and very sadly, in 1991, Sydney Piddington passed away. Many years later, in 2000 and something, Leslie Piddington unfortunately developed dementia. She couldn't remember the act, let alone the methods. So it seemed to the world of magic that Piddington's secrets were locked away forever. So I was minding my own business working in radio back there in the late 1990s, and I was working with the legend Paul Daniels. There we were, writing a book together, recording some pieces for radio, and my dad just happened to mention that his father worked for a famous magician once.
I remember years ago, when I was about 7 or 8, a man and a woman came to visit my father, who worked as a London taxi driver. And they came in, they were talking, and then they put this blackboard up and they started writing on it.
I didn't think much of it at the time. I obviously asked, really? Anyway, it turned out, after a bit of investigation, that the magician his father worked for was, of course, Sydney Piddington. It didn't click at first, but then it suddenly clicked. There was my granddad working for, or on behalf of, the great Sydney Piddington.
One of the shows he told me about was the Tower of London. I found very confused at that time, but now I can see what it's all about.
So, I had to look into this, so when I found time, I began to dig a little bit, and more and more came to the surface. My dad was 8 years old at the time, but he still remembers a lot of what happened then, and the big, big discovery came when, going through Granddad's old-time bits and pieces, we found an old RAF notebook. And on it, it still says, paper scarce, use both sides of the paper, please. It was an amazing discovery because it tied in with his work with the Piddingtons. He had made notes.
What he wrote down was the method that these couple called the Piddingtons done their mental act. And it was just unbelievable.
A bit more investigation revealed this, that and the other, and we came to the conclusion that, hang on a moment, we know how they did it.
They chose my father being a taxi driver because of his memory. If he could remember the knowledge, he could remember how to do the tricks.
Of course, there's one question still remains, and that is, Sydney and Leslie Piddington kept their secret secret for nearly 70 years. So, is it right for me to reveal their secrets to you now?
I think the Piddingtons were doing their stuff back in the 1950s, so there's been a long time since they did it. We're in a different world now, and for that reason, I think it's fine for people to, or for you to disclose the methods that they use.
We want this history down, and we want it down so the Piddingtons can show off that they were one of the revolutionary performers, the showmanship, the what they did, how they fooled people, and how they, back in the days, I mean, they were as big as Tom Cruise. And they were the superstars of their time. To this day, no one could figure it out. I mean, it's fooled thousands of magicians, and finally, a book that comes out revealing their things the secrets and the methods would be incredible. Otherwise, it's going to go down in history and with nothing.